Lastly, this week, I want you to start thinking of novels in terms of their literary classification. So, what we're going to do is an overview of the different classifications that My Antonia would fall into and how it could be classified in the different ways. So, we're going to do an overview of the Gothic novel and romance. We're going to be looking at realism and regionalism slash fiction that embeds some sort of local color. So, in no particular order, and these all range from about 1860 until about the early 1900s. And even though My Antonia was not published until 1918, it definitely has flavors of all of these because the author was alive, influenced, and writing during these literary periods and genres. So let's learn kind of what it is to be a Gothic novel in a romance. I know that we tend to think of a romance as somebody just falls in love and happily ever after. That is not actually the literary definition of romance. Romance is a period. It was a romantic period during which that's kind of what they called the time period because art and literature and drama and movements at that time had certain themes, and it was called the romantic period. But a lot of the themes were very dark, and it wasn't sort of your happily ever after mentality. So let's go ahead and look at the novel. The American novel is actually a unique type of book. Not many novels existed prior to this time. If you think about earlier texts, Shakespeare wrote dramas. We had other English writers would do sort of like moral tales or things that would teach people lessons. It's called didactic literature. Or else it might be a technical publication, a commentary, like for a magazine on human nature. There were definitely stories, but stories had a different purpose than what the novel is intended to communicate. So let's go ahead and look at what a novel is. And this comes from a definition. The word must signify, besides the more obvious qualities of the picturesque and the heroic, an assumed freedom from the ordinary novelistic requirements of verisimilitude, development, and continuity, a tendency toward melodrama and idle. A more or less formal abstractness, a tendency to plunge into the underside of consciousness, a willingness to abandon moral questions or ignore the spectacle of man in society or consider these things only indirectly or abstractly. I know that there's a lot of big words. Basically, what it's saying is the novel is written purely as an art form. It explores all sorts of things from human nature to symbolism to allusions to different texts. And it has sort of an indirect way of plunging into the human consciousness that may never be resolved. It doesn't have a nice bow at the end. It doesn't necessarily have a moral conclusion. It just is simply an art form exploring human nature. The main difference, it says, between the novel and a romance is the way in which they view reality. The novel looks at reality closely and in very comprehensive detail, and it takes a group of people, it sets them going about the business of life. And then when we see these people in their real complexity, in their motives and their temperaments, and with their relationship to nature and to each other, to their social class, to their past, characters are much more important than the action or the plot. And the tragic or comic actions of the narrative have the primary purpose of enhancing our knowledge of and our feeling for a particular character. So the events that occur are usually plausible given the circumstances, but they might have a violent or sensational occurrence in plot, and it's introduced through a series of scenes. Historically, it has been said that the novel has served the interests and aspirations of the middle class. So essentially, what differentiates a novel from a short story? It's an ongoing look at the depth of the characters and embedding artistic elements and comments on themes of kind of human behavior, culture, class, nature, and human relationships. So that's a novel. A romance, in contrast, feels free to render reality in much less volume and detail. It prefers action to the characters. Actions will be freer in a romance than a novel. It's less resistant to reality. The romance can flourish without providing intricacy of relation. The characters, usually they're two-dimensional. There's not a lot happening between them. They're not going to be very complex, relating to society, toward their past, to history. Human beings will be shown in kind of a basic manner. They'll share some type of emotion, but it's basically just going to be like one level of emotion. They're not usually abstract or symbolic. Let's see. So the novelist, again, helps us to understand like where did this person come from and what are his deep-seated motivations. Romantic novel or the romantic author doesn't care. It's simply like, let's get these people married. Let's get these people through life on this. It could even be get them killed for a manner of speaking. It's simply the progression through life very quickly with a very narrow and shallow look at from the beginning to the end. American romances, it doesn't matter what class the people come from. It doesn't matter whether or not where he comes from. He's not going to be typically enveloped in mystery. Character becomes kind of abstract, so-so, and it's the plot may be highly colored. There might be a lot more kind of unbelievable events happening. So there you have it, the romance versus the novel. And so The Scarlet Letter, and we'll be reading these next year, so I'll just kind of skim over that for now. Now let's add the dimension of the Gothic. The Gothic, the purpose of this was to create terror, to go into the realm of the irrational, perverse, nightmarish, obsessive, to demonstrate the presence of the uncanny and the irrational. Characters might be an innocent heroine, but she's going to be persecuted by a lustful villain. There might be ghosts. Characters are going to disappear mysteriously, and there will be supernatural occurrences. There's going to be a tone that's like of doom and terror and mystery. It's usually an exotic setting, which could be like in the middle of nowhere. We're in this dark place, and there's going to be like moody rain clouds and extreme weather. Let's see. So, where do you see elements of the novel, the romance, and the gothic in Maya Antonia? Novelistic elements include the fact that we follow a character all the way from the beginning of his life until kind of middle age and the depth of his growth and progression. Romance would be his relationship to Lena Langard, his relationship to Antonia, and it's very shallow. We don't know a lot, especially from their perspective. We're not given very much. And so it's basically like, let's get to the end. Let's kind of figure out how these characters are related to each other. And then the element of the Gothic that she would have, Antonia could have been easily raped if Jim hadn't have been in her bed at the time, which got to read book two to find that part. And then also the suicide, unfortunately. So those are those three genres. We're going to move to realism now in American literature. Realism is very broadly defined as the faithful representation of reality. So anything that preserves reality as it is or as it was is accurate. You're not going to embellish it and say, oh, everything was. I mean, like, think of the Cinderella story. It's not realistic in both accounts. It's overly dark and it's overly optimistic. Whereas this book, or the objective of realism is just kind of this is what the what life was like. It's a reaction against romanticism, in fact. It was interested in the scientific method, systematizing the study of history. It had the influence of rational philosophy, all kind of blended up into realism. And critics suggested, and authors suggested, that people just want to learn, like, what is life like? It was paired a lot with naturalism, which is kind of as they tried to study the world and study human nature, they wanted to know. Cut out all the fluff and just tell me what this person is like so I can study it. And so you get a lot of biographies turning into, or biographical elements turning into realistic or novels that use the theory of realism. In American literature, it encompasses a period of time from about the Civil War until the turn of the century, which would be about 1900. So Mark Twain, Henry James, some of the others are going to write fiction that is devoted to accurately representing and exploring American lives in a variety of contexts, from the rich to the poor, from white to black to the immigrants. And that's what the story does in a very real way. It was a movement that encompassed the entire country, from the Midwest to the South and everywhere in between. And there's more we could say about it, but that's all I need you to know about realism for now. I think it's pretty clear to see where there are elements of that in her book. And then we get to regionalism and what some scholars call local color fiction. And so regionalism preserves the dialect, the customs, the topography, which means kind of the landscape and features of a particular region. It was influenced by Southwestern and Down East humor between the Civil War and the 19th century, but then it became representative of every single region. Regional literature incorporates the broader concept of sectional differences, so it's sort of like there were different dialects, different ways of life. Clearly, if you're living in New England and like this country has been settled now for over 100 years, and they have electricity, they have cars, versus the frontier where people have just moved out there 10 years ago. It's a completely different way of life. And so what it does is it intentionally looks at the characteristics of the different regions to try to preserve, like, this is America in all of its glory. Characteristics of this would be the setting is emphasized. It looks at the natural elements, nature. Settings are frequently remote and inaccessible. The setting is integral to the story, and it sometimes becomes a character in itself because it is such a presence and almost like an antagonist for the characters in many ways. The characters have a lot of stories to tell. They will embellish people and look at their features, talk about their dialects, stereotypes and personality traits for a particular region. In women's color fiction, heroines are often unmarried or young girls, and that's what we see in this book because it wants to look at they are a type of region and local color in and of like kind of in isolation apart from men. So that would be another characteristic. There's usually a narrator. It's an educated observer from the world beyond. He learns something and then goes back and looks in a sense down upon or in a nostalgic way to where he came from, and that's exactly what we have here. There are also plots where nothing happens. In these stories, that little happens. They include a lot of storytelling that revolves around community and rituals, but it's not moving forward in a plot-driven sort of way. Themes are not what like an it says an antipathy to change, a resistance to change, a degree of nostalgia for this like this past golden age that was so great, the celebration of community, acceptance in the face of adversity, thematic tension or conflict between like the urban and the suburbs, so like or the rural, so it's like the country and the city, or the old-fashioned versus like the newfangled ways of doing things, the intrusions of outsiders or interlopers on what community has always been. And so you have writers from a variety of different areas representing New England, the South, West, Great Plains, and the Midwest. And their techniques would typically be to use a dialect, authenticity of regional characters, detailed description, infrequent use of the frame story where there's a narrator telling the story, which is what we have. So your task then is to decide in which ways so distinguish elements of each literary movement in this novel and give specific examples. How is this a gothic novel, romance? How is it real? How does it embed realism, regionalism, and local color? So hopefully that'll get you kind of into exploring literature and its classified genres.